With all the interest now in chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine as possible, very likely promising drugs for COVID-19, I thought it would be interesting to present some new material I have on the first reports of the introduction of quinine, the sort of natural substance of which chloroquine is an analog, into the Middle East. Now, quinine was one of the wonder drugs, one of the natural products that were discovered, or at least rediscovered by Europeans in the New World, in this, particularly in South America, and were brought over first to the Iberian Peninsula, to present-day Spain and Portugal, but then made their way east, eventually coming, as you see on this map, to Constantinople, today, of course, called Istanbul, the capital then of the very powerful and huge Ottoman Empire, and then making their way down through the empire, particularly to the area of Syria and the city of Aleppo, Halab in Arabic, which is where the source that I'll be presenting today comes from. Now, to the present, we've known of at least two sources of, that is to say, by medical writers living and working within the Ottoman Empire who bring us some information about these new substances. One is Daoud al-Antaki, Antaki meaning coming from the city of Antioch, not that far from Aleppo today in Turkey, and one of the areas in Turkey where the Arabic is still the main spoken language. A blind Christian physician, apparently very well loved in his day, who died in 1599. And you see here below a picture of a hospital in Marrakesh in Morocco, which is named after him. And the other, Salih bin Nasrallah ibn Salum, who al-Halabi from Halab, from Aleppo, who wrote several works and is best known today for his work or his description of the so-called chemical medicine, the Paracelsian chemical alchemical medicine, which he made known in the Eastern world in the Ottoman Empire. And it was actually a very popular writing of his. And we have many manuscripts, and it's probably the best studied aspect of this topic that I'm talking about today. Now, my work on the new manuscript source, which I am going to be describing in this video, has shown that another important book coming out of Europe and describing these substances was known to some of these writers. It's Nicholas Monades. You see here on the left his book, De Simplicibus. Simplicibus, the simples are simply plants and animals that don't have to go through any chemical process or any mixing. You can use them directly for medicinal purposes, such as garlic or petrosilia. And I have here on the right the very influential and joy to read English translation by John Frampton, Joyful News Out of the New World, describing some of these herbs. And as you see here, also the portraiture of the said herbs, Englished by John Frampton, Merchant. Now, the new source that I will be reporting on today comes from a manuscript which I was shown by the people who were inspecting it for Sotheby's, the famous auction house. It's a manuscript written in Arabic language and Hebrew characters. Many of these we have, including many medical manuscripts. And the book, or the books are books of this which describe materia medica, that is to say, substances that are used for medicinal purposes. But what was really interesting were the marginal notes. By marginal notes, I mean these things here written in the margins, where someone who owned the book decided to add a description of a substance that apparently was not known at the time of the person who wrote the book, and adds it as a note in the margin. And I found several of these, all seemingly related and coming from the same Jewish person living in Halab in Aleppo, which describe new medicinal substances, two from the New World and one from China. And I wrote this up in a paper that was published in 2019, and there's a link in the description. But here, I'll be talking about just this one description of a medicinal substance which is related somehow to quinine. Now here, I have just the marginal note, and I've circled at the top the name of the substance, which is written out in Hebrew letters, kinakina. This is quinine or kinakina, I'm not sure how you pronounce it. The name of the substance, just what its precise identification is a matter of some controversy, which I'll be talking about in a few minutes. And at the bottom, I've circled what we call the colophon, which is where the person who wrote the note signed his name, and we'll be reading that in the next slide. So here I've typed out the colophon, the signature, and translated it. In Arabic, it says, on the right, that is, وَهَذَا قَوْ سَرِيرُ الْأَتِبَى وَالْكُتَبَى مُوسَى وَلَلْحَبِيبَ الْحَكِيمَ اللَّوَانِي نَيْرُ نِتْسِرَوْ رَمْبَنِيسَى سَتْ سْفَرَدِي تَهُرْ أَكَارْ أَمَيْنْ كِي رَتْزَوْنْ. And the translation, as you can read here, this is the statement of the youngest of the physicians and scribes. Doesn't mean that he's actually the youngest in age. It's a sort of self-deprecating expression of modesty. Musa, or Moshe, Moses, the son of Habib, the Levite physician, may the high and sublime protect him, pure Sfaradi, that is to say, not from the sort of the original longtime denizens of Aleppo, who would be called Mustarab, but from the Jews who were expelled from Spain at the end of the 15th century and was settled in various parts of the Ottoman Empire. Amen, may it be his will. And so now we come to the translation, the full translation of that rather long note in the margins. Kinakina, also pronounced kinakina in Arabic. We have two letters, kaf and kaf, and it makes a difference how you pronounce them. In some dialects, it would, instead of kinakina, they would say gina-gina or aina-ina. It's not quite sure. He knows of two ways that of the name was being pronounced, which already tells us that it was fairly well known and that people have been pronouncing it in different ways. It's the bark of a new tree, wonderfully useful in the land of the New World. The New World is actually written out in, it's a Turkish word that he writes out in Hebrew with letters. French merchants bring it to all countries. It resembles cinnamon, except that its taste is bitter. Its color is cinnamon-like. It possesses some acridity, and it is hot and dry in the second degree. It is a deopilant, that is to say, it's good for removing hair, a diaphoretic, and something that induces sweating, which then and now is thought by many to be a part of treating certain illnesses, a laxative and an emetic. It is wonderfully useful as a prophylactic, something that is to say something you take as a preventative medicine, as a prophylactic against fevers, chills, and periodic fevers. Periodic fevers would be, of course, malaria with its paroxysms. These, depending on the particular parasite that infects the person, there will be a bout of fever every 2, 3, or 4 days, something like that. Its utility in this has been attested, validated by experience, tajriba, and verified many times by all the schooled physicians. Wallameen, I mean, I think he means here those who actually have gone through whatever formal medical education there was in those days in the Bimaristan in the hospital, especially with regard to the phlegmatic temperaments, those who were classified as having a bodily constitution which tends towards the phlegm, very wet constitutions, where there is much dampness. It has added action and utility in their case. The utility of this drug is evident from the first, second, or third time that is administered. It's to say one usually needs no more than 3 doses for it to take effect, and it will heal with the help of God. It is sufficient and adequate for that illness. I assume he means here malaria, without any drug, that is any other drug, when does not need anything else. This alone will cure it. The manner of its administration and the quantity to drink. A child should take half a mithkal, it's a certain weight. A youth, a full mithkal, and for a strong temperament, as a full-grown strong person who can handle a good strong dose, should take two mithkals. It should then be finely crushed, like sand. You crush this bark, and then brewed in a pot of fine, fragrant wine, or else in the roots decoction. It's a sort of brew made of various roots of vegetables and plants. However, for the person with a yellow bilious temperament, it should be brewed in rose water, and for the phlegmatic, in orange flower water. That is to say, we make this drink specially designed for the different temperaments, so that it should be well received by the body and effective. It is brewed in the evening and imbibed in the morning. I think it simply sort of boils on a slow flame overnight, and then in the morning it's ready for you to take. So, as I said at the beginning of this talk, there's some controversy, some lack of clarity as to exactly what plant he's referring to when he calls it kinakina. In particular, there are two plants which seem to be good candidates. One is the cinchona, from which the quinine that we know of is made, and you have a picture here, or another tree called the Peruvian balsam, which has a lot of medicinal properties of its own. It's not, say, is quite as potent as the cinchona, but it was known and used. Now, as I said, there was a great deal of confusion and controversy as to just what plant was involved in these descriptions, to the point that a certain A.W. Haggis, writing in the 1940s, published a two-part study in the Bulletin of the History of Medicine on fundamental errors in the early history of cinchona, in which he went through all the descriptions and attempts at identifying the plant that was that the various authors publishing in the 16th, 17th, 18th century were talking about. And it's a very useful publication still now after 80 years, but it also has a few quirks and things that have to be ironed out, as I discovered in my own research. Now, one of the books that Haggis found to be most useful in trying to sort out this mess and figure out just which plant was being spoken about it in a given text was this book written, as you see here at the bottom, completed in 1653 by a Jesuit priest by the name of Bernabe Cobo, called Historia del Nuevo Mundo, History of the New World. Haggis finds that his descriptions are the most accurate, and he has descriptions of both of these plants that we're talking about, the cinchona and the Peruvian balsam. And so I'll be using his description of those two plants to try and see which plant it is that my marginal, the writer of the marginal note that I'm speaking about, this Moshe Ibn Habib, had in mind. So I made this little chart here in which I went through some of the parts of the description of Ibn Habib that have corresponding passages or sentences in the description of the true plants in Kobo's book. And what we have here is, first of all, the name. Well, the name, of course, is the same. Ibn Habib calls it kinkina, so it's obviously the same as the thing which is called quinakina by Kobo, and which Haggis decides is actually Peruvian balsam. But the next three items, which are not quite botanical descriptions, but close to that, that you use the bark, and that it's like cinnamon, and that it's bitter, all correspond to what Kobo says about the fever tree, which is actually the cinchona, the source of our quinine. Now, the next item, which is really important from the point of view of early pre-modern medicine, is the classification by the four qualities, hot, dry, wet and cold, each of which has 3 degrees. This is the pre-modern equivalent of a true scientific classification, where you actually measure the potency of the drug in these 4 categories, and then you use them to decide what to use to treat an illness when illnesses are also classified as being hot or dry or wet or cold in these 3 degrees. And here, the description of Ibn Habib's kinakina being in the second degree hot and the second degree dry matches exactly what Gobel says for the quinakina. Now, with regard to the dosage, Kobe says nothing about the quinakina, but what he says about the fever tree, the cinchona, the quinine, it more or less corresponds to Ibn Habib. Ibn Habib says it requires up to 3 doses. Kobo says that the fever tree, the bark of the fever tree, reduces fever soon after the first dosage. Sounds like what we hear today about chloroquine. The kinakina is multipurpose. We have that long list of it being at the opulent, emetic, and so forth. And this is also what Gobel says for the quinakina. And it's taken with a decoction, some sort of, you know, base of some brew of herbs or whatever, and wine. And that also is what Gobel has with regard to the preparation of the quinakina. So we see here that it doesn't quite, it doesn't match either of them precisely. If I were to take the medieval or the pre-modern classification in degrees as the most important variable, I would say that Habib is talking about the quinakina, which is actually what he calls it. But saying that it's a bark that looks like cinnamon and reduces fever very quickly makes it sound like it's the cinchona, the quinine. So we see here that even with the great amount of research that Haggis has done and this useful book by Kobo, matters are still not quite clear as far as the identification of this substance. Now, some further observations. First, the report of Ibn Habib has many details missing in the description of both trees by Kobo, which leads me to conclude that Ibn Habib has seen a different source, perhaps adding some items of knowledge that were added in the East. So I'm not sure he doesn't name his source, which he does in some of the other marginal notes. And it seems from the style that it's like some of the things he's copied from Ibn Salum or from Al-Antaki, but he doesn't mention either of them, so it's not clear. Then I also want to call attention particularly to the statement of his that his utility has been attested, validated by experience. This is what we call today anecdotal evidence. Now, anecdotal evidence, tajriba in Arabic, was an important part of medical epistemology and, in fact, was used in a number of sciences and disciplines. And I will try to put a link in the description of an article that I published on tajriba and the way it was applied across the board in medicine, but even in political science and other areas. Its validity was at times grudgingly accepted by school-trained medical professionals. The idea is that this is what we call anecdotal evidence, in that we have many reports that it works. We don't understand why it works. It doesn't make any sense to us why it works. We don't know how it works, but it does work because we have so many reports of it having been applied successfully. Now, on our own day, we have this additional criterion, which is probably the most important one, which is statistical analysis, something that the ancient and medieval and early modern medicine didn't have at all. We, of course, you know, we ask for randomized trials, and then we decide on the results whether the efficacy or the supposed efficacy of the substance is statistically significant. They had no idea of that. But nonetheless, the idea that anecdotal evidence, the fact that so many people report, both of medical practitioners as well as patients and just your ordinary, you know, citizens who are looking for something to help them in their misery, and this thing seems to work, was an important factor in validating and making the substance acceptable. And as I say at the bottom, in my humble opinion, anecdotal evidence always has been and always will be part of medical practice. That has to do with a number of things. To begin with, many people who come to the doctor aren't really sick, so whatever the doctor may give to them hasn't really cured them. And a lot of other factors go into this, but this is something which today, of course, is part of the controversy about chloroquine, but it's not new. It's something it has been, and I think will always be an important part of medicine. Now, just to bring this up to date, chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine, the substances that are now being used widely as part of the protocols in very, very advanced hospitals, as well as by many, many medical practitioners with advanced degrees and a lot of experience. It's an analog of the active ingredient in natural quinine. It was discovered in 1934 by German scientists working at the Bayer laboratories. During World War II, Allied forces in North Africa captured the drug and sent the material back to the States for analysis, leading to renewed interest in chloroquine. They wanted, it was important to have an artificial analog of the substance in case our access to the areas where quinine was grown. And by now, it's no longer so much South America as it is Java in Indonesia and India. And it was introduced into clinical practice in 1947 for the prophylactic treatment of malaria. People, even to this day, take this with them when they travel to areas that are affected by malaria in case they get it. And then hydroxychloroquine is simply a version of this a substance which has less severe side effects. So thank you, and I hope you enjoyed this video.